Basanto, and you will start
Okay.
the welcome part and then pick it up.
Yeah, Sabha, I'll now start the session. So, welcome again to this session on scaling of natural farming model in Odisha. This is one of the session which is part of today's event, the whole day event, Odisha Vikas Conclave 2020. So thanks Wason RR Network. So they are anchoring this session. It's an important topic in today's event, scaling up natural farming model in Odisha. So we all are now moving towards organic farming, or we can say it is natural farming in other way also. So day by day, it's also getting prominence in our policy and budget framework. So this is a very important topic to discuss here. So I would also introduce the guests who are in the today's session. There are so many eminent personalities who are becoming part of this session. So let me first introduce Mr. A. Ravindra, who is the executive secretary of Wason, and he has played an instrumental role in promotion of agroecology and watershed development in the country. So he is also a co-founder of RRA Network, who has influenced the renfed agriculture programs such as National Mission on Sustainable Agriculture, National Rural Livelihood Mission, Odisha Millet Mission, and Natural Farming at Andhra Pradesh. So welcome Ravindra ji to this session on promotion of natural farming. Then let me also welcome Dr. Sabyasachi Das, who is the director at Wason, and he is also a national coordinator at RRA Network. So he is currently looking at conservation and promotion of animal genetic germplasm and scaling of agroecological approaches. And he has been instrumental in conservation of native animal breeds such as Kharai camel, Nalawala Thurupa cattle, and Malkanagiri goat. So he is also currently working with national and international partners such as TERI, NRAA, FAO, FOLU, and others. So welcome Dr. Sabyasachi Das to this session. Let me also welcome Mr. Prasanta Mohanty, who is a founding member of Nirman and currently serving as secretary cum executive director of Nirman. He has a good years of experiences, that is 23 years of experiences, and had a dynamic role in advocating rights-based concerns in the areas of community forestry and sustainable agriculture and livelihoods. So welcome Mr. Prasanta Mohanty from Nirman to this session. We have also other guests who are joining with us, Dr. Amar KJR Nayak, who is a professor in XIMB in the Department of Strategy and General Management, Xavier Institute of Management, Bhubaneswar. He was also a former NABARD chair professor. He has worked extensively on design thinking and systems thinking, transition strategies for sustainability, strategic management, Indian multinational strategy, among others. So he is also a member of multiple committees at national and state level. So he will be also joining with us. And Padmasri Sabarmati Appa, she will also join with us. And we all have heard she has recently got the Padmasri Award. She is very phenomenal. She has a very phenomenal impact on the wide gamut of areas like conservation of forests, ecological regeneration of wasteland, biodiversity conservation, sustainable agriculture, promotion of village sanitation and hygiene. So more than 3 decades ago, she along with her father, Professor Radhamohan, had sown the seed of organic farming in a small patch of land in Noyagarh district, which has now become a huge tree, spreading its roots deep as a statewide movement. So we'd also welcome Padmasri Sabarmati Appa. She will also join with us. With this, I hand over the session to Dr. Sabyasachi Das, so sorry, I would also introduce my apology, Mr. Minhaj Amin, who is the anchor of National Coalition for Natural Farming. Sorry, so he will be also joining in the panel. So thank you, I missed you, sorry. So with this, I now hand over the session to Dr. Sabyasachi Das to take it forward. Sabyasachi.
And thank you to all our distinguished panelists and also thank to all of the participants who have joined this in this program. Just struggling to so we'll start this session today, and we have most probably 1.5 hours time. And we need to accommodate all the speakers, distinguished speaker to speak, and then there is a open discussion for this program, and then there will be a conclusion. So I would probably request all the speaker to stick to the time, and there are I will give that how much time you might have. To start this, a little bit about the background of this, why this session. And we must thank CYSD to organize this Odisha Vikas Conclave. And this initiative has been a phenomenal initiative in Odisha. And I now see that these initiatives has actually brought in a lot of civil society organization and the government together in several development work in Odisha. And I see that this program, which started around 5-6 years back, that actually helped a lot of dynamism in the development processes in Odisha. And thanks to Jagdanandaji, as well as the government of Odisha, to move in a more vibrant manner in the development thing. Audio is not getting. Someone is saying that audio. People are able to hear me.
You are audible to me.
Yeah. Okay. So the background of this natural farming, scaling up possibilities of natural farming in Odisha. Let me give you a bit of a background, and then other speakers will also talk about it. But probably 20-30 years back, many of the farmers primarily, and then the civil society organization have initiated process which is probably called as organic farming, natural farming, ecological farming, so on and so forth. And recently, if I look at the last 5 years, there is a lot of initiative by some of the states, particularly in the state of Andhra Pradesh, where they have started Andhra Pradesh community managed natural farming system, which got the imagination of a lot of policymakers, and including the NITI Aayog, who has been instrumental in supporting and giving a lot of solidarity to the natural farming processes, where several of you have started the work probably 25 years back, probably the generation kind of an experience now we have. So in this background, several of the organizations who have been working on the natural farming, sustainable agriculture, organic farming, ecological farming, whatever name you say, in Gujarat, it might be Sajiv Kheti. So all these organizations, RRA Network, and several others, RYSS has come together and set up a coalition, which is called National Coalition for Natural Farming. And now, through this session, we would like to see that how do you think, because all of you have an enormous experiences on the ground to take up the natural farming and helping farmers to get into the natural farming processes and practices. And we would like to listen from you and discuss that what would be the strategy to scale up natural farming in the state of Odisha. And several of you have done a lot of work on this. So your experiences will be very, very useful for to understand what are the systemic thinking. And I'm very happy that Vasant has introduced the panelists of today, the speakers of the today. And Professor Amar Nayakji, I know him personally very well, and he has been giving some of his inputs to the RRA network also in several forums, several workshops. So we would like to listen all these things. From the panelist, Amarji has joined. Can I just get a Basant, can you just confirm that whether Amarji has joined?
Yes, Sabyasachi.
Amarji has joined.
90.
Okay, just check that whether Amarji has joined or not.
No. Sabyasachi, Amar sir has not joined yet.
Okay, so I will start with them. Then I will start with Minhaj, my friend who has been the anchor of National Coalition for the Natural Farming. And I would ask him to introduce the National Coalition and its objective to all the participants. And I would request all the speakers of we have four speakers today. Then another presentation will come from Ravindra. So total five presentation. And I would request all the presenters to stick in 7-minute formula, 5+2. I will be, after 5 minutes, I will give you some indication that there are 2 minutes left, and I will follow that. I will keep the time and then I will come back. So now over to you, Minhaj, to introduce the National Coalition for Natural Farming. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you. Let me share my screen. I will try to keep this presentation as brief as I can. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
So, once again, it's real pleasure and delight to be with the partners, the organizations who have been working in the area of natural farming in Odisha. We see a tremendous potential for adoption of natural farming at scale, given what's happening in the government and given the experiences of such a diverse set of organizations who have been working diligently on this for many, many years, like Sabya was saying, almost a generation. Today, I will just introduce you very quickly the National Coalition for Natural Farming, the work that we are doing currently and our intention, hopefully open for collaboration and partnerships to see how we can work with some of you and to do this, take this work further. So our vision is essentially to create a coalition for accelerating the learning practice and policy discourse related to agroecology-based farming practices in all its diversity and variances. We are not stuck to one particular idea. The objective is to bring people, experiences who are working in the direction of agroecology-based practices, come together and see how we can create different solutions for different climatic zones, different contexts. And there's a special emphasis on empowering socially marginalized groups, marginal farmers, landless workers, and so on and so forth through this process. And also focus on areas which are environmentally vulnerable. And we want to do this work through farmers collectives, through grassroots organizations, and also ensure that women farmers are always sort of looked for in leadership roles. Our objective is to build an ecosystem to support a national, state, regional initiatives. We want to bring at least 2 million champion farmers within 5 years, which will lead to hopefully 50 million small and marginal farmers practicing natural farming in 10 years, leading to 30 million hectares under natural farming across the country. And we want to also ensure that we generate evidence to demonstrate that this is feasible. Natural farming delivers on all the different scores necessary for India. And we have very simple guiding principles, no synthetic chemicals and GMOs. The practices should be friendly to soil, life and the planet. Diversity, like I was saying, in every aspect, biological approaches, frameworks. Also ensuring that it's not just farm-based work, but we provide the ecosystem services at the landscape level. Also, create an environment for it to become a people's movement. It's driven by champion farmers and the local initiatives, and make it as decentralized as possible. We are working in various different streams. We call them sutras, building experiences, building capacity, conducting research and innovation and documentation, trying to influence the existing formal and informal education system, building a communication platform that kind of interacts with all different stakeholders, including government and consumers, and building a resource pool of practitioners that can influence the scaling. We have a very high impact steering committee. I will not go into the details, but Professor Abhijit Sen, Mr. Jagdish Rao, Ms. Kavita Kuruganti, Dr. Mihir Shah, Mr. Vijay Anand, and Mr. T. Vijay Kumar are on the steering committee, and that has really helped us to connect with many different stakeholders, both in India and outside already. So far, in terms of capacity building, we call it capacity enhancement because already there is so much happening on the ground. We are working in Gujarat, in Himachal Pradesh, in Karnataka, in Maharashtra, and also a little bit in MP and Rajasthan through RYSS. Also, we are conducting some Pan-India program. We have engaged with AKRSPI on conservation agriculture without any chemicals with 22 organizations around 6 states. This program has already started. We're also planning an initiative to set up bioresource input centers across the country. And that program will be launched hopefully soon. And we're also working on how we can work with various organizations who have managed to create market linkages and market know-how, which can be then leveraged for natural farming producers. In addition to this, we have realized if we want to really scale the adoption of natural farming, we'll have to do capacity building through digitalization as well as field trainings. So we are working on a model which will ensure that the digital content is of the highest quality, and also from the experiences we have learned, we want to make this content and the capacity building training in local languages and very contextualized content based on the agroclimatic zone and the social and the cultural setting of the different areas. Use local resource first people for training and capacity building. Also ensure that the programs are not very long, but very short, but very high frequency, and engagement at the long term with the champion farmers and local communities, so that we take them through the journey of adoption of natural farming. Also, we want to include assessment and support programs so that this training really is high impact. In Odisha, we feel the risk experience of the Odisha organizations is very valuable for now scaling natural farming. And we expect the Odisha partners not just to see what can be done in Odisha, but also play a major role at the national level. We invite them to join the coalition and hope to hear more from other members today. And then looking forward to interactions with all of you in coming months.
In 2 minutes.
Thank you so much. I'm done. I'll pass it back to Sabya.
So nice. Thank you very much, Min, that you have actually completed this before your the allocated time. I would also request Vasant to check whenever Amarchi and Sabarmati ji joins, please add them into the panel list so that they can speak. Now I would request Prashant ji. And Vasant has introduced him already, and we know that he has been doing the work on the ground most probably more than 20 years, and he has a huge experiences on the forest ecology, on millets, promotion of millets, and then biodiverse agriculture and ecological farming, and so on and so forth. I would request Prashant ji from Nirman to share his thoughts about how he thinks, because he is a part of a civil society. He is also part of the lot of policy work in Odisha, and how he thinks that the scaling up can be possible, and what the civil society organization, farmers, and government should do to take this thing agenda forward on the ground. Now over to Prashant ji. Prashant ji, you are in mute. Can you unmute yourself? Yeah. Can you also on your video?
Okay.
Yes, you are visible and you are audible. Yeah. So 5 minutes plus 2 minutes. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and thank you all the panelists. And I'm audible.
Yes, you are audible.
Actually, Nirman, the experience which we have been this like last mostly last 15 years we have been in this ecological agroecological practices, and if you look at because our interest to in this ecological farming or agroecological practices basically came to searching how we can make the farming more viable option, because we came from the background of the farming villages, and we've seen the kind of difficulties that farmers has gone through. So that is a trigger to do something for farmers and farming families. So that such that took us from towards organic ecological farming practices. And so far from last whatever the work we did at ground with farmers, so we had both experience at Adivasi and also the Adivasi and other farming communities. And from ecological farming practices, from low input farming practices, from it would be like SRI, or it would be like same the ecological practices in applying other crops, like where this sugarcane has been the most water intensive crop. So we tried how these practices could be used in like sugarcane, and we can reduce the use of more water in this sugarcane, and more also it would be more ecological practices. So those experience which we did with farmers in Noigad, in other parts of the state like Kanmur, Raigada, so and we found and when we work with the farmers, so basically if you want to upscale kind of things, we need a certain kind of institutional arrangement. Otherwise the upskilling, any kind of farming practices is with digital farmers is quite challenging. And and though we didn't have the very standard institution with all areas, but from our experience, we work with the women SDGs, we work with farmers groups, and we work also like business, like a management committee. Those also to mobilize them also the ecology farming practices. So different kind of institutions we work, and some have started direct working with farmers. But our learning came from this process. So always it is better to upscale through a kind of institutions, and maybe we need to reflect and also make a common standard, a set of like practices, like systems, so that is required at this time. And one thing that and second also like the learning we had. It is not like typical training, the kind of when you talk about any kind of learnings to the farmers. So it is like both way. It is like learning, we should take the learning from farmers and also share the knowledge which we have, we bring into these processes. So it is like knowledge sharing should be always should be like both two-way process. That should be also should be. The knowledge sharing and understanding and would be a more would be like both way, like it is like two way processes. It should be not like we know and we want to share something. Farmers should understand. So farmers has different kind of also practices, different kind of knowledge system. So that both should be integrated in the whole process. And the next thing, what we see that. When we talk about different kinds of the practices, lot of innovations also farmers try to do at the ground. So and we should not be always very that is a typical like this is the standard process. So we should allow that if the farmers are trying some kind of innovations at ground. So that should be also given space because lot of innovations at ground also comes up in the whole process of working. And we have seen because we have different kind of process, like in Daspalla we had ecological farming program in Daspalla. We have also we are partner with the Millet Mission in 3 blocks. So there also a lot of work is going on ecological farming, while we are promoting also reviving the millet systems in this area. So and there is some the area in Kandhamal also we are trying with organic participatory guarantee system, organic certification process with organic council PGSOC. And the kind of institution is different in different places. But now we, after coming lot of years of experience, we feel so though institution is inevitable for upskilling, but we should have some kind of standard, not exactly standard as I can say, but some kind of common systems in this and. The other thing is, other important things we always give focus on the local seed system, because that is more resilience to this at this time of climate change, and we have been focusing both on farm conservations and also developing local seed of farm, and also we also promoting also the cluster based seed bank, because we had experience that when we have village-wise seed bank, so I think that is not a very viable model, because when people always used to conserve seats at their own household level. So again, also bringing institutions at village level is not required, and it would be better to have a cluster level kind of seed bank, and that works better as a viable model what we experienced in our facilitation process. So that is also local seed. How to strengthen the local seed system is more important, and we also working towards in that direction, and the sharing of seeds, because seeds building seed system.
Prashant ji, 2 minutes.
It is not only to develop the local conservation and local seeds. It is also how to improve the local seeds. So that is also another challenging also task, and that has to be also work with the farmers to improve the local land races. And so far we have some of the experience village seed bank. We didn't find much that is very operationally viable, but if you have a cluster seed bank, that is really working and it is very operational. It is a workable model, and that is working very well from our experience. And while working with equal natural farming systems, we also integrated the kind of like it is where also the rice duck system should be required, but we can integrate if there is in desi chickens also, because you don't support other the livelihood integration with this natural farming system, because that won't be strengthened, because they have very small chunk of land. The farmers are being 1-2 acres of land, so that you have to, which integrated farming, there should be also the what are other options which there that should be always explored and supported. And now our work also towards also the value chain, we are now working with farmers producers group, so the how they will also the farmers groups would better benefit from surplus whatever they have, better remunerative prices, and also value chain they can also or link to the such market. So these are small the areas which experience we have been working, and there is a lot of adoption of this ecology farming practices, and these are most of the areas we had the experience that the most of the farmers is adapting. So people are adapting like from this biocell local vegetable seeds, more seeds, more like more paddy. Some areas we found like more than 40 like on a block, but varieties of rice has been consumed, more other vegetable seeds have been, more types of vegetable seeds have been, and consumed. Even the people have left like daspalla, ragi, which was most of the crops which used to be grown those area. So now bringing back the lot of ragi with also lot of little millet to this area. And the lot of mixed farming system have been also revived in the whole process. So I think the learning which we every organization now have, so now people are working in different ways. It should be time, we should share and come up with our own each learnings and what works best, what doesn't work well. So we should be keep open to that, and we should also develop a strategy with a more collective way to upscale the whole process, and government can also be a good partner, because now government is more proactive in this kind of work. So if you can, that could be taken as a more a collaborative program like a millet mission kind of things. I think this would be a very good opportunity and would be option for a scaling of the natural farming in state of Odisha. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Prashant ji. Thank you for you have talked about that there is a need for more collaboration, like government has done it in Odisha Millet Mission. You also spoke about the need of institutional approach while scaling up the natural farming in Odisha. You also said about that there is a need to understand the ecological principles and the farming systems approach to be adopted in the scaling up of the natural farming. You also spoke about that the learning of the farmers as well as the civil society organization, there should be a two way of communication and learning, because it is not about that we know and the farmers former sir actually knows better the how to take this process forward. And then I also noticed that you have spoke about very important aspects of the natural farming, that is probably the seed and what should be the local seed system that we need to bring in. And it might not be the village level, but we need to come out with a kind of a system which may be at the cluster level to see that the diverse natural local seeds are being promoted through the process of natural farming. I think Natural Coalition for Natural Farming will look into to understand and collect the all the experiences that the civil society organization and farmer in Odisha, they have developed it over the period of time. There might be a different agroecological setting, so practices might be changes, but there might be a common principle. I think what you have tried to say is that the common some common principles will let us take up and then see that how the practices are changes and which are developed over the period of time that may be tried out in different different agroecological zone through the institutional mechanism. Thank you very much. There will be some kind of a questions and answer session. There will be open session. Please keep yourself into the panelist section, and we'll come back to you. Thank you very much. So now there are some noises coming. Just check that. I would now request Ravindra. Ravindra, who have been part of several initiatives, not only in Assam but also the collective initiatives that has been taken up nationally. Particularly, he was instrumental in conceptualization of RRA network, revitalizing rainfed agriculture network. Then he has been into the as an advisory committee into the national coalition. So I would request Ravindra to actually see through that what is the transformation required, the approaches to scale up the natural farming in Odisha. Over to you, Ravindra.
Thanks, Savya. Thanks for the opportunity. Thanks to CVSD and Jagdananda ji for the opportunity. I think Prashant ji has laid out a good background for discussion. My purpose here is to actually set the stage for this. What are the questions that we need to discuss? Now we need to deliberate upon. So that is the purpose of my short presentation. Now, Yes, Chairman. Okay. So when we look at natural farming in the coalition, there was lots of discussion, and then the approach that is taken is a broader framework. We have organic agriculture, we have permaculture. My good friend Sabarmati has been working in on IMOs, biodynamic agriculture, ZBNF, regenerative agriculture, nutri gardens. Watershed development has such elements. SRI, Odisha pioneered lots of scaling up of SRI. SMI is now coming up. There are several niche innovations. All these together, the common elements are, these are all non-chemical based approach, knowledge based approaches, and regenerative in practices, and mostly use internal inputs, and highly location specific and community driven. So whatever are these approaches, these are the some kind of common principles that bind them. So together, all these things, the direction it sets is what we are calling the natural farming. So if you look at the natural farming as an agroecological approach, then what is that we should look at? So far we have been working on with farmers, with individual farmers in some small scale, and probably watershed development is one that is an area-based approach. But now if you look at can we actually move into a transformative phase where we can actually look at gram panchayats, watersheds, or the habitations in total transform towards agroecology principles, transform towards a natural farming paradigm. This is what we need to look at. not just, you know, trying few farmers to be organic, not trying few farmers to be doing permaculture, not just, you know, some small group of farmers linked with markets alone. But that is all important. But more important is this, all these innovations together, can we have something like Green Revolution did, from a subsistence farming to another way of farming, from Green Revolution kind of farming to, can we also look at a transformation towards a natural farming paradigm? No? So the two aspects of this is how we regenerate the ecosystem services. Second, how we actually align all the production systems, be it agriculture, livestock, fisheries, commons, forests, all these production systems towards agroecological future. This is what we are calling transformation. So conventional approach to regenerative processes, we need a lot of shifts. One is input to knowledge, and then a lot of investments on the behavioral change. Earlier, it's all, you know, selling inputs, technologies packaged into inputs, either it's seeds or chemicals and all that. But now we need to address a lot of behavioral change, which is only possible by practicing farmers as evangelists, as messiahs, as champion farmers who actually transform their own villages. And then, you know, we need a lot of investments and knowledge rather than inputs. And then we need to regenerate biomass, which is the most difficult thing. Investments on regenerating biomass, and from monocultures to diversified crops. These are the challenges of a transformation to natural farming, you know, if you look at the landscape level. So knowledge and practice, behavioral changes, location specificity, you need to have integrated approaches, biomass-based approaches. These are the contours of the change. The key questions now before us is that if Odisha embarks on a journey where substantial part of its landscapes, be it in the tribal areas or the dry lands or the coastal areas, now if the substantial part of these areas transform towards a paradigm of natural farming, which is in its various elements of all that we are saying encompassing, then if you want to affect that large scale transformation, we need essentially to move away from simple implementation of a project, a defined set of activities, to process of transformation, both at the community level and at the landscape level and at the knowledge level. You know, to make this effective, to make this transformation, what is that we do? And what is the role of the civil society? So far, we have been promoting organic farming or biodynamic farming or permaculture or something. But if you want to look at large-scale transformation of villages, panchayats into natural farming processes, what is that the civil society do? What roles that we should encompass? What kind of engagement we should have? And then what is that the government do? So like Green Revolution has all the support systems. Now, everything that you talk about agriculture, be it extension or seeds or inputs or credit, markets, knowledge, everything is oriented around a particular type of agriculture. Chemicals, using fertilizers, I have all the systems available. I can go to the bank and get credit. I can go to the insurance and then insure my crop. I can get the seeds of high yielding varieties or hybrid varieties. Companies are there to provide me seeds and all that. But if I am a natural farming farmer, then what? We don't have any. So how do you reorient the kind of support systems that actually are around agriculture, current agriculture, to actually engineer, to support a process of engineering transformation to ecological farming? You know? So what kind of input, labor, services, output markets? How do you reorient them to natural farming process? Unless we reorient these larger support systems, then we cannot talk about larger transformation. We can again talk about one FPO, doing organic, and then selling it to markets, or one good permaculture farm that we sell it. We remain at that. But now Odisha government has embarked on this journey. They have already instituted Odisha Millet Mission on the principles of agroecology. Earlier, SRA was also taken up by the government in the form of agroecology. So there is a sort of acceptance by the government to embark on this journey. But key questions are, how do we do it? since the government is also agreeable, since the civil society have elements of this framework in place, demonstrated with capacities, then how do we actually come together to make this effect? What changes that we need to do? So this is basically the questions. Thanks, Avya. I think these questions, I expect participants will delve upon and then come up with lots of suggestions so that we can actually process them and then embed into some kind of a state level program, about something like Odisha Millet Mission in terms of natural farming program. So that's the expectation.
Yeah, thank you very much, Ravindra. And I would request just to check the logistic part of it. Basanto, if someone wants to speak from the participants, they can raise their hands and then you can allow them to speak. Is it the format? Basanto or someone from CYSD?
Sorry, Ravindra ji.
No, Basanta, I am saying now
yes.
Go into the open discussion session, and if the participants, if they want to say something, they can raise their hand, and those who will be raising their hands, they can be unmuted by the system from your side or from my side also, and then we'll allow them to speak, and then we can have the open discussion.
So far two hand raise options are there. We can unmute here also to allow them talk, and you can also unmute, but you suggest to whom you will call by order, we will unmute here.
So my request to all the participants that we have said, Ravindra probably have set up the agenda on the open discussion. Prashant ji has given a bit of a background on how the civil society organization in Odisha have tried to take up this organic farming or natural farming from the ground. Minhaj has talked about the whole national coalition and how they are taking it forward in a large scale, what kind of a capacities that is required. And then, so therefore, I would request and will be very, very interested two things. One is that if you have the suggestions on three aspects, one is that how the natural farming can become a movement in Odisha and become a mainstream program in Odisha. When Ravindra's last slides was that, what does it mean by mainstream program? So means everyone, the government and the civil society organization, everyone is part of that. So this is my first questions to where we would like to have your input. The second question is that what would be the role of the civil society organization if the movement has to be succeeded, or the mainstream program on natural farming in Odisha needs to be succeeded, then what do you do expect from the government to support these initiatives, to support this movement and to support this mainstream program on the natural farming? So I would go by some of the hands and been raised, and we are very sorry, probably we have 1:30, we can do this session. I need to check that, but we have some hands are raised. The first hand I see from Shankar Narayan Mohanty. You raise the hand. Can you just speak? And while you are speaking, you need to tell, you need to introduce your name and from where you are coming in and your organization or probably what you are doing. And you can suggest any suggestion for these three aspects. And if you have any questions to the panelist, you can ask that question. But keep yourself brief so that we can take more inputs and suggestions from others. Probably you can speak for 2.5 minutes. Thank you.
Yeah, so we are giving the option of unmuting yourself and speak. Please unmute and speak. We have given you the option. Shankar Narayan Mohanty, please.
Secretary of the
Shankar Narayanji, you are still in unmute. Can you unmute and speak? Okay, so there is a problem. Next, I would go to Deepak Misraji. As I said earlier, please unmute yourself and speak.
Hello, I'm audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. I'm Deepak Misra from organization Vaitran Initiative. Okay, so basically the questions you have raised, the thing is what we found, even civil societies and whoever the facilitators, all are working in the same line. Actually, what happened, all are working in the supply-driven line. If it could be a demand-driven, suppose if market can be created by XYZ organizations, someone is working in the technical part, someone working in the data management, then it could be a holistic approach actually. In any program, in a Millets Mission, in everywhere. So what we are doing, we are all working behind the farmers. So very less people working in the demand side. We all are working in the supply chain. That's the very gray area that we are struggling actually when we get the production. That's the number one. Number two is in Odisha context, the data management and the technical input we should give to the farmers and even larger at the state level, it's not up to the mark, to be very frank. So somehow we must work on that. And the third thing, it's my question actually. The thing is, we are working in the wild species sector. So how wild species can come into the agri field? Because this is the demand of the hour. Huge species are going very rapidly endangered because of market demands. So it's obvious that all species cannot come because of its scientific operation. But many species can come down. So there are other states, they are well advanced from Odisha. Chhattisgarh, even West Bengal, they are well advanced in wild species, bringing wild species to agri field. So in this context, we are working, but we are working on a very small scale. In this context, is there any scope or hope the panelists or others can enlighten, then that will be great for us to work around. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Shankar Narayan Mohantiji.
Deepak Misra.
Sorry. Deepak Misra. Okay. Sorry. I'm very sorry. And I'm just requesting Ravindra to note down that the wild species can also be part of the whole system of natural farming, that he may answer after some time. And we picked up your thing that holistically get into, and several people needs to work on the separate field. Yeah. Thank you. Now I would like to invite Dr. Patanjali Tripathiji. If you can unmute yourself and then talk about your suggestions, and if you have any.
Yeah, I am audible, sir.
Yes,
hello.
Sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you,
yes, sir,
for
ahead.
Inviting. Yeah, thank you very much for inviting and giving this opportunity. I am Dr. Patanjali Tripathi. I am working as a principal consultant, Bloom Agriculture International Private Limited. So that's an MNC. It's a joint venture of E. Kutir River Service Management Private Limited and Fair Trasa of South Africa. So my suggestions would be very specific. I don't like to take much of time. One is, it is natural farming is a welcome initiative. I fully subscribe to the views that it will be a national movement. But the constant is availability of input. As Mr. Deepak Misra said, there is a constant in respect of data management also. Inputs are, I was involved in implementation of Kaya program. So, even at the government level, farmers' data are not available for disbursement of Kaya benefits. Somehow, now that things have already improved to a very substantial extent. Second is type of seeds that for natural farming, because now the movement that Bloom is like to bring about is organic farming. And we face a lot of difficulties in motivating farmers for switching over to natural farming and organic farming because of this non-availability of inputs. So good quality of seeds, that is number one, and availability of biofertilizer, biopesticides to promote and foster natural farming, that is also another common area. And most difficult, what I visualize, is marketing, because farmers are now tuned to use more of fertilizer and getting more of production, and still they face a lot of difficulties, particularly in respect of vegetables and other. There has been widespread distress sell, except paddy to some extent, and others in respect of others also, where government intervention is not so forthcoming. So we need to, the civil society and corporate sector need to address this one, availability of seeds for promoting organic or natural farming, availability of biofertilizer, biopesticides, and there are a lot of pre-harvest management and post-harvest management, and free availability of advisory from agricultural scientists. So if these are taken care of, I think definitely I am very optimistic of India and Odisha switching over to natural farming. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Patanjali ji. And probably I will take one more suggestion, and then I'll go to the panelists with some of the thing that you have asked, and then before you, another participant had asked, and we are also getting some questions in our chat box. We'll try to address those. Thank you for your suggestions, particularly looking into the problem, current problem related to inputs. But we are also looking at that instead of thinking about there is a need of a different kind of an inputs, bio inputs and etc. Can we look into that how we can provide the knowledge, how we can transfer the knowledge, and how we can look into the agroecological practices that actually reduces a lot of input requirement, and we need to as Ravindra said, they need to shift the paradigm from input based agriculture, monocrop agriculture, to the knowledge based and agroecology based farming practices. I'll come back to we will also come back to you on your other questions, but now I'm going to Jayanti Swine. Can you unmute yourself and give your suggestion on three aspects, how it can be mainstream, what would be the role of civil society, what government should do, and how we can actually do the better extension system on the ground to scale up the natural farming in Odisha. Over to you, Jayanti ji. Yes, go ahead. You are mute. Can you unmute yourself? Jayanti Swine. Kanika Development, that is the name it is coming. Can you hear us? Unmute kar lijiye. Unmute kar lijiye. Okay, I think now, okay. So Ravindra, there are some questions in the chat box also. Can you take up some of the things that people has asked, whether how the wild species can be brought in, whether it is through the seed system and etc. There are some other questions in the chat box, that what is the status and plan of natural farming in Odisha term through civil societies, and the farming and marketing on the two sides of the same coin of agriculture. So what action proposed for marketing of natural farm produces? This is the questions from Vasudev Nayak ji.
Yeah,
thank you very much. I think it's very, very important to, I mean, agrobiodiversity is one of the core pillars of natural farming. It's always a continuum, you know, wild species coming into agriculture should be a continuous process. Unfortunately, it has stopped long back. Purchase. So you need to find lots of variation in the biomass that can be locally adopted. So that's a very important point. I think it's part of the work. I think like people like Dinesh should help more in getting into that areas of work. Inputs and markets are very important. But what we are looking at is rather than somebody supplying inputs, there is an input industry that develops. Earlier, there is no Fertilizer Corporation of India. There were no fertilizer factories around this thing. All came up along with Green Revolution. So what kind of market stimulation should be there when natural farming is adopted at scale and in a large scale? So what kind of inputs and services, be it machinery services, be it input services, or knowledge, how these develop in the mainstream, in the market segments is very, very important. So it is not sufficient that we artificially, provide something, but the regular provide those services. Markets may not be big corporates. It can be small markets at the village level, at the panchayat level, or at the block level, district level. Industry can also be, at the village industry. It can be a panchayat level, input provisioning at the enterprise development at the panchayat level. That can actually serve about 1,000 farmers. That can be a potent industry, decentralized industry development. So all these things are still to be innovated. There are small examples here and there, but it is important that the mainstream players also come in. The small enterprises come up, the startups come up at the village level, at the panchayat level, at the block level to provide such services. This is an important part of it. So far, when you talk about organic farming, we talk about niche markets. But when you talk about transformation, the mainstream markets need to transform. Say, for example, the logistics around markets also need to change. We talk about diversity as one of the underpinning principle of natural farming. Without diversity, there is no natural farming. But markets prefer monocultures. Markets prefer single product of one particular quality, not diverse quality. So how do you engage with consumers to consume diversity rather than prefer only polished, single size grains, as a preferred ones. So a lot of education need to come into the market. The psychology of not just the farmers, but the consumers also need to be engaged with. These are all important facets of transformation that we need to work on. It is just not sufficient to work with farmers alone. You need to work with farmers and the systems around the farmers, the public support systems, the consumers, and then their mental attitudes and all these things. So that is very important point, Patanjali. So it is not just, I see the question as not just supplying biofertilizers, but how do you actually deal with a lot of market players and their transformation into supporting natural farm is an important issue. And there are some questions related to soil carbon and all that. It is true that you cannot improve soil carbon in a small period of time. It takes a lot of time. But is the soil carbon only issue? No, it is a tendency towards building up the soil is what we should look at with multiple crop systems, with the trees coming into the crop systems, integrated crop systems, with livestock getting integrated into the landscapes. Bullocks coming back into the probably coming back into the system in different ways, foraging systems getting strengthened. So all these are things that we need to work here. This is what I broadly see. So Jagannath ji is saying we need to have network with the lead agencies in all the agriculture zones. That's very, very important because agroecology plays an important role. if we actually look at different agroecologies of Odisha, is a very good suggestion by Jagannath Chatterjee ji. We need to identify who are the players there, who are the market players, who are the civil society players who have engaged with the subject. Who are the players who innovated good recipes of diversified products? Probably that also. No? And then we need to build that coalitions at the agroecological zone level, at a level where innovation is possible. Resource centers, and these are all very important suggestions. Then I see the questions, more or less this one.
So now I would also like I'm getting another question from our chat box. I will come to Pramila ji after some time. I just saw that your hands is raised. Abhishek, who is also working with the Natural Foundation, he is also asking that Odisha is the state which is rich in natural organic clusters. Our chemical fertilizer consumption is far below than the national average. How can we could leverage our tribal acceptance for the natural farming and natural farming cluster in Odisha? The thing that he is asking. Prashant ji, would you like to answer this? Sanjay Nirman, would you like to answer this?
Which one?
So the question was that in Odisha and many of the places, tribal farmer is actually doing the natural farming, means primarily the non-chemical. There is a lot of diversity. How we should utilize this strength to promote the natural farming in Odisha? That might be the questions from Abhishek.
Actually, in most of the tribal areas, the traditional way of farming, basically, this is also a way of natural farming. There is also by different programs, there's some shift from the traditional farming to some like mainstream farming. But still, even in the different, you try the pockets which is still untouched by any other kind of programs. Still, people are practicing a lot of ecological farming practices. But bringing to whatever they have in the knowledge system, because I'll just share one or two examples. Because like in Kutia areas, they have like a kind of a mixed farming systems, which is 15. To more 20 types of crops and have been there combined in a particular in the cropping systems. A lot of millets, a lot of pigeon pea, a lot of varieties of this other kind of vegetables, some kind of tubers. So they have the kind of systems are there, but it is now we should we can bring their knowledge system, because always we see they are doing like the practice is more primitive, more underdeveloped kind of things. But if you look at the kind of things, the system they have been doing over the years, that is a particular kind of systems. I think that cater there all the family requirements around the years, and the crops also which is they've been harvesting different point period of time. It is not like one time, because like one experience I'll give you in when hudhud had affected a lot in like Ganjam areas. And it's partly also their crops also been affected, but not all the crops affected. Because some of these, the crops like those are very tall in the systems. Basically, there is that fallen, but the other crops also they stands in that time. And the cropping, that's the time of also different time. Also crops are in this. So that was sustenance in kind of after these also kind of. So I think this is the now time, it is a high time. We should also explore with open eye. So what they have, because these tribes already preserved this knowledge system, and how we should see that is not typically looking at like a yield as a parameters of enter. You should look at inter system what is contributing and how we can combine it in our processes, and we can
Thank you, Prashant ji. Now, Pramila ji, if you have a suggestion for the way forward for the promotion of natural farming in Odisha, and if you have any questions to our panelist, you can do it. Please unmute yourself.
नमस्ते
जी.
मुझे इतना इतना थोड़ा समझना है कि अभी जब हम बात कर रहे थे कि सिविल सोसाइटी क्या कर रहा है, तो मैं एक सिविल सोसाइटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन में काम कर रही हूँ और पिछले 50 साल से सारे आदिवासियों के साथ काम कर रही हूँ. तो मेरे एक अभी प्रॉब्लम जो है नेचुरल फार्मिंग के जो हम फेस कर रहे हैं फील्ड में, उसी के ऊपर मुझे थोड़ा एक दो मिनट बोलना है. आप पैनलिस्ट को मुझे सुझाव देंगे क्या करेंगे. जब हम देख रहे हैं अभी भी जो फ्रेंड बोल रहे थे कि ट्राइबल में डंगरिया और कुटिया इन लोग के साथ काम कर रही हूँ सौरा, तो उनका जो सिस्टम था अभी भी है बहुत सारे एरिया में, जो उनका जितने कल्चरल एग्रीकल्चर पैटर्न है जो नेचुरल फार्मिंग के पूरा है, लेकिन जो अभी जो सिस्टम डेवलप हो रहा है, जैसे बहुत सारे एरिया में टोबैको कल्टीवेशन हो रहा है, कॉटन कल्टीवेशन हो रहा है, यूकेलिप्टस बहुत सारे लैंड में हो रहा है, जो बहुत सारे ऑब्स्टेकल क्रिएट करता है नेचुरल फार्मिंग के लिए. हम मिलेट जो मिलेट के लिए काम करेंगे या कोई रागी के लिए कर रहे हैं, और जितने सारे जो उनका जो अपना क्रॉप था, जितने से जैसे वो कर रहे थे रागी कर रहे थे, ग्राम्स कर रहे थे, बहुत सारे स्पाइसेस देते जैसे जिंजर टर्मेरिक ये सब कर रहे थे, उसी एरिया में अभी बहुत सारे जो इकलिपटस है और टोबैको कॉटन ये सारे जो मोनो कमर्शियल क्रॉपिंग सब बहुत सारे हो गए, और ये सब क्रॉपिंग के लिए बहुत सारे सपोर्ट मिल रहा है गवर्नमेंट एजेंसी के लिए से दूसरे दोनों से ये सब मिल रहा है. तो अभी जब हम जहां हम कब कर रहे हैं एक जगह पे जब हम नेचुरल फार्मिंग के लिए बात कर रहे हैं जो कर रहे हैं उसको प्रमोट कर रहे हैं, वो बाकी सारे एरिया में ये सब जो ज्यादा से ज्यादा फर्टिलाइजर दिया जाता है, ज्यादा से पेस्टिसाइड दिया जाता है, ज्यादा से ऐसे सारे क्रॉप है, तो बहुत बड़े ऑब्स्टेकल है. हम जब सिविल सोसाइटी आज सिविल सोसाइटी आई एम फेसिंग लॉट ऑफ प्रॉब्लम बिकॉज वी आर ऑलवेज प्रमोटिंग नेचुरल फार्मिंग सिंस आवर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इंसेप्शन आवर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन. सो दिस इज द प्रॉब्लम व्हिच वी आर फेसिंग फॉर प्रमोटिंग एंड स्टिल वी आर डूइंग. सो दिस इज द क्वेश्चन टू ऑल द पैनलिस्ट, व्हाट टू डू. This campaign should be stop all that. That should be the way forward, I think.
Thank you, Pramila ji. I will also ask Ravindra to respond on this. Before that, Ravindra will also talk about that how in Andhra Pradesh the program of natural farming has taken up into a multi-cropping system, looked into the 365 days soil covered as a cropping system model. So probably he will take that up. And I am also looking at there are one hand raise, and there is one questions from Debraj ji. But I will allow now Sindhuja Nandini Mishra to suggest, and also if you have any questions. You can unmute yourself and then speak. Sindhuja Nandini Mishra ji, unmute kar lijiye. Ek bar unmute kariye. You are in mute. Yes, go ahead. Thoda sa parichay de dijiye and then your suggestion and if you have any questions.
Sir, hello, very good afternoon to all my respective sir and all my colleagues, those who are with me within this conclave. Sir, my name is Sindhu Chandini Mishra from Odisha.
से सर हटा देंगे तो ज्यादा अच्छा रहेगा, क्योंकि इन द सिविल सोसाइटी हम लोग सब लोग नाम से पुकारते हैं, और थोड़ा सा अगर उम्र से ज्यादा होंगे तो जी लगा लेते हैं या भाई लगा लेते हैं. बट डोंट स्पीक सर प्लीज.
इट्स ओके सर. बिफोर स्पीकिंग समथिंग आई जस्ट वांट दैट क्वेश्चन अगेन.
गो अहेड.
No, sir. No, sir. I want to know about that question. You are asking me now one suggestion. That's why.
So one thing was that what Ravindra said, agar natural farming ko large scale mein leke jana hai Odisha mein, to civil society ko kya karna chahiye, government ko kya karna chahiye, aur hum log ye transformation mein kaise ja payenge. Ye tha sawal, usme upar aap logo ka inputs chah rahe hain, suggestion chah rahe hain.
Dusra baat ye,
आपका कोई क्वेश्चन है तो आप पैनलिस्ट के लिए कुछ अगर क्वेश्चन है तो कर दीजिए.
No sir, I don't have any questions about this, and I mostly prefer that civil society should do more and more and put focus on that natural farming, because Odisha is as we know that Odisha is one of the best. Best for this natural farming, because as we know that nature is matlab ki nature ne matlab ki apna jo amanat hai na Odisha ko hi di hai. To mere khayal mein Odisha mein jo farming jo hai uska agar hum log kuch karenge to Odisha bahut upar jayegi.
Thank you very much. Now I have seen that there are couple of questions. One is from Devraj Boy. आप अगर बात करके आपका questions को रखना चाहेंगे वो आप रख सकते हैं. उसके बाद विद्याधर महाराणा, उनका भी एक questions उन्होंने question box में chat box में रखे हैं. But आप अगर unmute करके आपका questions को बताना चाहेंगे one. एंड आपका सजेशंस अगर बताना चाहेंगे जो इसमें हम कैसे आगे बढ़ पाए एज ए कलेक्टिव ऑफ सिविल सोसाइटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन टेकिंग द गवर्नमेंट टुगेदर, कैसे हम नेचुरल फार्मिंग को एक मूवमेंट करके एक कैंपेन करके मूवमेंट करके लेके जा सकते हैं. विद्याधर महाराणा जी, आप कुछ बात करना चाहेंगे? देवराज
साहब, सो एक्चुअली एज यू नो देयर इज अ लिटिल बिट डिफरेंस बिटवीन ऑर्गेनिक फार्मिंग एंड नेचुरल फार्मिंग. सो इन उड़ीसा गवर्नमेंट हैज ऑलरेडी डेवलप्ड ए पॉलिसी फॉर ऑर्गेनिक फार्मिंग इन उड़ीसा, बट नो सच पॉलिसी हैज बीन डेवलप्ड फॉर उड़ीसा फॉर नेचुरल फार्मिंग. सो एज आई लर्न द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया इज ऑल्सो फोकसिंग इन देयर बजट about the zero budget natural farming, which has been practiced by some civil societies here and there. But can you, is there any data available that how much time it will require to at least increase the organic matter content of the soil by 1%? That is my first question. Second question, what are the yield difference between the organic farming and natural farming in the similar locality under identical condition? Because in organic farming we have to, it is knowledge intensive, so we have to spend more. But in natural farming also, so there are some costs involved in natural way. It is not completely zero budget natural farming, but it involves some costs also. So what is the yield difference between the two, so that will be possible for us to promote natural farming in the way Subhas Palkar was discussing the other day. So my question is that specific, what is the time required to increase the organic matter content by 1%? What is the yield difference between the two?
Ravindra, would you like to take that in this question?
Yeah. So I earlier mentioned that thing. Organic matter, organic carbon percentage increase is very long cycles. We are not actually, what is that we are now looking at? I think we need to be looking at it very carefully. We are looking at the direction. Say, for example, if you take 1960-65, when Green Revolution was first introduced, at that time, nobody knows what could be the potential yield of Green Revolution in 1980 or 1990. Green Revolution was starting at that time. So, and there were no, everybody knows the bread varieties for input responsiveness, they started using fertilizers, but nobody knows what is the package of practices eventually, which crop, which practices and all that. So, but what government did, because green revolution was perceived to be required at that point of time, they wanted productivity to increase to feed the nation, whatever the notions they have. They have set up a process of green revolution. What is the process of green revolution? They have set the direction that the metric is high productivity in well-endowed areas, and government will provide all the support. It will provide minimum support price, it will provide fertilizers and subsidies, it will provide irrigation, all kinds of things. So it's not that all irrigation is available at that point of time. All dams were not built in 1960s, 70s. But the direction of that green revolution was set in 1960s, 70s. Similarly, if we actually compare the current state when we are in 2020, 60 years after that, we are in a situation where green revolution has exhausted. And we see all the problems of that. Now, the country needs to move to a new way of looking at agriculture. That direction, we are calling it natural farming. It's not that natural farming, the day you shift, will yield that much. This is a direction where the direction parameters are, you restore ecological services. You build the capacity of the soil to produce nutrients required for the plants, and then the plants interface with the soil microbial organisms. These are a long-term process. Like fertilizer companies coming up took 30 years. It did not come overnight. Similarly, restoring ecological process probably may be very large, a longer period of time. So by moving into a new paradigm, new way of doing agriculture, where entire country, entire world is now aspiring to, even FAO came up with agroecological guidelines. So government wants to do it. Community wants non-chemical products. So we are now embarking on a journey to increase organic carbon at some point of time to 1%. That some point of time, maybe 30 years, 40 years, whatever it is. Right. So the question before it is, if we think this journey is important, we need to get onto this bus, leaving the earlier things, what is that we do at scale? It's not that we have I think somebody has written there, it's not just sufficient to do some small innovations here and there. We need to embark on a larger journey, larger transformations. So now, what are the parameters of that transformation? What are the processes of that transformation that we need to collectively evolve and then make the government accept, make the market also accept that parameters. Everybody starts working towards that direction, then people will come up with lots of innovations. At this point of time, none of the chemicals were actually invented by the agriculture research system. All the chemicals are coming from the market, from the private players, right? But the trigger for that was laid out in the public systems in the green revolution times. Similarly, what are the triggers that we need to set up now that actually stimulate the economy, stimulate the market players, stimulate the industrial players, stimulate the communities, small business, everybody and breeders, everybody to look into what are the requirements of the journey and setting up the processes of evolving that, innovating on that. I think that's my larger answer.
So primarily we are looking at the answer to you is that don't get into the debate whether the yield, how much yield will increase. So then again, we'll go into that productivity and the yield discussion rather than the way forward towards the transition.
Because Savir, just one more point, the term productivity may also be redefined. What is productivity is now looking at what is the per animal milk yield? What is the per acre paddy yield? That may not be the productivity at all. We can actually see productivity as in one particular watershed, what would be the total quantum of ecosystem services that are provided, which can be valued. So productivity may be completely redefined in this process. Yeah. We're talking about a new paradigm.
Yeah. So that all these, thank you very much, Ravindra. Now, I will take two more questions and suggestions maybe. And then we'll go back to the conclusion 5 minutes. So probably by 1:35 we'll close the session. Now I see that there is a two hands are raised. First, I will give a chance to Dilip Kumar Sahuji. you can unmute yourself and then talk. And then Patanjaliji, whether I do not know whether it is the first older hand raise or you want to ask and the question. But now I am going to Dilip Kumar Sauji. Aap unmute kar lijiye. You can unmute and then you can speak. Dilip Kumar Sauji, unmute kar lijiye. Unmute yourself. Yes. Now.
Sir, I am very fortunate to give to receive an opportunity to speak in this occasion. Sir, my suggestion in this workshop is. Sir, in civil society side, sir, I am a CSR.
आप लोग, सर जी, सर निकाल दीजिए, फिर बात कर लीजिए. Thank you. Go ahead, Dilip ji.
Sir, actually, we need to conserve old seeds, sir, in like seed bank and seed conservation is. Highly demand in this context, and then sir, soil testing should be there at the civil society side, and the farmer producer group that need to be formulated by the civil society. Then sir, and another thing is empowerment and capacity building should be at the civil society side and the government side. The government should provide IC material, sir, in the baseline, sir. There is no such institution in Orissa, sir. Only there is Krushak Sathi are there. So, sir, we need to provide more technical support to the Krushak Sathi, and by giving the inputs and everything, we, sir, increase natural farming, sir. That is my, sir.
थैंक यू दिलीप जी. थैंक यू वेरी मच. आपने बात किया, आपने बात रखा. दिस इज द लास्ट क्वेश्चंस दैट वी विल टेक सजेशन प्रोबब्ली. डॉक्टर पतंजलि जी, आप कुछ बताना चाहेंगे? अनम्यूट कर लीजिए.
थैंक यू सर. आई एम द सेम पर्सन हु गेट एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू स्पीक अर्लियर. सो thank you again. Only thing I emphasize on the knowledge gap, sir. There is wide knowledge gap between the laboratory and the lab. So what Rabindra ji said, I 100% share with his views, his concerns. This transformation can happen when all farmers are well, all are stakeholders, not only farmers, consumers, market. They get the appropriate knowledge to contribute towards transformation and be a partner in that transformation. So starting from agricultural scientists to consumers to market players and to farmers, so if that can be taken care of with a focused attention, then we'll achieve this transformation and natural farming. Thank you again, sir.
Thank you Dr. Patanjali ji. Rabindra, so now we are probably have 3 to 4 minutes to conclude this session. Would you like to speak on how we can take it forward now after we have listened some of the civil society member, the business stakeholders and all that?
Yeah, thanks Abhya. I think the important points, takeaway points from the session are, one, Dinesh ji ne bataya ki now we need to look at wildlife species. And Pramila ji ne bataya ki, you know, there's a rich experience with the tribal communities on natural farming in their Podu land, so in all forms of tribal agriculture. So how do we actually learn from that and then integrate that into the natural farming processes is a very important area. And then now another important point coming up is, now we cannot look at natural farming as just as ecology. The point that made by several people is that economy is equally important. It has to generate livelihoods. Prasanth ji ne acha bataya ki, no, unless you generate livelihoods for the people, natural farming is not feasible. It will not go forward. So how do we embark on a journey of natural farming that generates more income for the people and that triggers the economy much better than the current way, where, you know, the markets are vibrant they prefer organic farming, work with consumers. No? So that is one important point that has come up in the this thing. And then this seeing this as a long-term process. There's also one question, what is the status of this discussion in Odisha? Probably Dinesh or somebody would be better informed, but to my knowledge, the state government is inclined to look at natural farming as a large program in the state. There was one consultation was done with several officials of the agriculture department with Mr. Vijay Kumar and others. So the consultation actually, Dr. Garg was also there. And then there was an interest by the government to see how it moves forward. Subsequently, government has constituted a small committee to look into the natural farming practices in several different states and then come up with some kind of a draft guidelines for the Odisha state. That is the status of this thing. And this is the time I urge all the civil society players to come forward to actively build, provide your ideas, build on your experience, provide that content into framing this natural farming program in the state. It has to be location specific. It has to be agroecological specific. But the key challenge is how you actually move away from just implementing one project, so many check dams, so many this thing, that thing, from that to actually a transformative process where natural farming becomes a community-led and a larger people's agenda, supported by the government, supported by the society and the economy. I think that is the direction where we need to take. There are several innovations came from Odisha. We look forward to several of the players to come and enrich the whole process. This is a broad message I got from this conclave. This session, Sabya, and I close here.
So thank you, Jamin. Would you like to say a couple of words at the end? 30 seconds.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ravindra, for such an enlightening response to such interesting questions that came up. I am really thankful to CYST, Jagdanandaji, and the entire team for hosting this event, a timely event. And we look forward as a coalition, national coalition, to work very closely with all the partners who are present here and many more to see how we can create a pupils movement of scaling natural farming with the these new parameters that Ravindra was talking about. Thank you so much.
Nice, thank you, Min. Thank you to all the participants and the member of the civil society organization and participants from the business, other organization and institution. I would like to thank all our panelists and the speakers, particularly Prashant Ji, Ravindra, and Minaj. I would like to thank particularly CYSD, not only for organizing giving us opportunity to host this session, but also that OVC process that they have been taking up so rigorously. And that is being in quite an interesting platform for all the civil society organization to move ahead with the developmental activity in this. But I am really looking forward to more conversation with the civil society and others in Odisha. And we would like to engage more on behalf of Natural Farming Coalition, as well as the RR network and all the work that we have been being part of as a group. Thank you very much. Now over to Vasanta.
Yeah, Sabyasachi, thank you.